All right, everybody, welcome back. I hate to interrupt the music, but we've got a pick band phase to get through here, and it's getting started with or without us, and I'd prefer it to be with. My name is Octavian. I am joined by Rapid, the Faster Master Caster, who's going to be doing some color casting for me today. And we've got George Mason facing off against Oklahoma State. Now, George Mason are looking in raring form to go ahead and take the 2-0 sweep here, if that first game is anything to go by. But Oklahoma State still have the opportunity to play spoiler if they do manage to take home this series, which would be quite a feat given that earlier performance. They will actually be able to, provided, of course, South Florida lose their matchup that's going to be coming up, make a three-way tie in this group, and that would be really exciting and interesting to watch. So I'm kind of rooting for that. I'm supposed to be unbiased, but I have to say I'm kind of rooting for that a little bit. I always like more League of Legends. But one way or another, it doesn't look all that likely, not with the performance that George Mason put in last game.
Yeah, well, first of all, the big secret is that no casting is ever truly unbiased. if you play video games, you do that because you're very passionate about them. And if you're a passionate caster, as you know you should be, I think that's fair to say, then you feel strongly about stuff. Now, I mean, there's more bias and less bias, and there's reasonable and unreasonable. But all that to say is that, you know, I like stuff, you like stuff, we all like stuff, and that's why we're here, to watch good stuff happen. Yeah. So when good stuff happens, you're like, hey, I like that. And that can be biased, but I think everybody understands that, you know, we're all here for the same reason, and it is to watch some cool League of Legends. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit about that. So first off the bat, we're going to see some reactionary bans. Maokai, Ryze, taken off the field. No surprise there. But that does leave up the Ivern. Also, Graves on the field, so mm-hmm. That's a little bit weird. Not going to be the jungle Talon, so I think we can all be a little bit happy about that. But we'll see how that works out, because this is almost guaranteed going to be an Ivern pick for Ghoul.
Yeah, and I think that would serve him a lot better. It's a little bit more reliable coming out of the jungle. You've got that utility to fall back on if things start to go sour, which they did relatively quickly last game. I think equally surprised as you are at the Graves pick, though, because I think Graves was left up last draft for GMU, and they didn't opt for it.
For Firefly, that was kind of a pocket pick. Mm-hmm. So he was just like really looking for, or not Firefly, for Guo, that was definitely a pocket pick, going for the Talon, because he really goes for I mean, that's, like I said, I mean, pocket pick is pocket pick, but it's going to have to stay in his pocket for now. So we actually get a chance to see some interesting stuff here. Yeah. We're going to see Gragas locked in for Oklahoma, and we did get a chance to see Gragas in LPL this week. If I'm not mistaken, it was a jungle Gragas, so I don't really know if we're going to see that with the Nocturne locked in, but yet another sort of pocket pick here for Wu. Definitely loves that, you know, lethality, loves the aggressive jungles, but we'll see if this time goes better.
Yeah, haven't seen a lot of Gragases for a while now, basically since the changes to explosive cask and the travel time, really, on the projectile that was added. Talon hover is a little bit of a prod towards Guo, I suppose. But, you know, I really feel like there's just a lot of freedom in this draft for GMU now, given how well they performed last game. They might be able to sort of branch out of the standard composition which they were running and pick some more interesting and, interesting might be the wrong word. Interesting from my perspective, because I do see a lot of standard compositions, but some more flavorful things if they want to. But they're going to go back to the Karma Varus bottom lane. It served them well. There's really no reason to swap off of it. And we'll see what the answer is this time. I think Varus and Avocado do have to change up something, because that bottom lane was never really going all that well for the side of Oklahoma.
You don't want to telegraph the pick and ban phase just yet. Karma Varus both can be flexed into the mid lane, so want to maybe put a pause. But now it's most likely just going to be their duo, because we did see the Karma support in the last game. But keeping an eye on the other side here. Just trying to think about the way that the Scragas Nocturne idea works. So one big way that you can do it is, like, when you Nocturne ult, you can't, you know, see anything unless you have Banshee's Veil, and then it's a little bit unfortunate for you. But then you can, like, Gragas ult somebody into a scary place. They won't know, you know, oh no, it's scary, and you get picked off. And that's one way to do it. Also, you can predict where the Gragas cask is going to knock you. and you know, get your curtain calls off a little bit more accurately with Jin. Some options there, but that is going to be the duo lane locked in, most likely in response. Now, I don't know about you, Octavian, but there was a guy in the top lane who did pretty well in the last game, so got to keep an eye here on Ion and whether or not he wants to be the guy to grab, not Maokai this time around, but another big super tank. Now, Teemo's being hovered here, and I believe it was promised earlier. I don't think it'll actually be picked. Yeah, sorry about that, guys. I don't feel too bad about being dishonest if I break my promise to play Teemo. Let's just be real. So, no Teemos, but it's going to be a Nautilus up in the top lane, as long as it's not some crazy jungle Nautilus. So Ion's still kind of playing the same idea, just a big tanky top laner. But this time, he's going to have to go into what I can only imagine is going to be a Gragas. Mm-hmm. And that's a weird matchup to go into. So looking forward to seeing how he decides to play that.
Yeah, I'm actually really curious to see how Can plays out the lane as well. And in particular, to see what he goes first as far as a max. I'm assuming it would be barrel roll just for the wave clear. And get maybe better dueling potential out of maxing his W. I'm really not sure how that lane is going to play out. Nautilus versus Gragas is one that we haven't seen in a very long time, just because Gragas did fall out of favor a good while ago. But the final pick that we do want to at least mention here is going to be Victor. So it'll be Victor v. Syndra in the mid lane. And any thoughts on these compositions, and that we've got them fully locked in here, Rapid? Do you think that this was a better draft overall for Oklahoma? Because they really did need to change up quite a bit from game one if they wanted to come out and have any chance of taking the series back. Do you think they've been successful?
Well, for any patch that emphasizes aggressiveness, like we said, the lethality changes, kind of mm-hmm. the big theme to 7.3, you're going to want to start looking at aggressive junglers. And that's what we have two of right here. So Graves, probably the more solid, the more like tried and tested jungler, because he's definitely been in the meta a little bit more recently than Nocturne has, that's for sure. So while if Ghoul can snowball, and same thing for his jungle talent in the last game, if you can snowball on that, then you're just going to like walk around picking up free money. This time around, he's going to have to work a little bit harder. Maybe ganking the Gragas lane, if Can actually plays this correctly, will go better than giving away the first blood like happened in game number one. Mm-hmm. Maybe that snowballs things. Maybe it doesn't. But at least as far as just like solid lanes go, I'm still going to be giving this over to George Mason. They've got probably a little bit more of a meta, not necessarily about the meta, but like ease of execution. Like that's why this, you know, the common saying, see hero, kill hero, you know, it's very simple. It's like, hey, yeah. we see the guy, we kill the guy. It's like it's not a big mystery. So it's, you know, it's not that it's not effective. It's just that it's very simple. It's like, hey, I see that guy, let's go kill that guy. So it's like a general strategy. You know, it may not have a lot of finesse to it, but hey, if you build your team composition around, hey, grab the dude, kill the dude, I think that's fairly easy to understand and execute, even if you're not like, you know, tippity top SKT LCS level. So we'll see how this works out, because this is going to be possibly our last game of the night if George Mason close it out and get themselves one step closer to these playoffs. That would also mean that their opponents, Oklahoma, are now fighting for their chance to keep their hopes alive. Mm-hmm. They do want to make it to playoffs as well.
All right. Well, I've just got a few sponsors to shout out here before we get into the game. We are sponsored by some wonderful organizations such as Band Gaming, which is a social gaming app and the primary app of the CSL. It's got features such as creating groups, which can be good for your CSL team, boards, calendar functions, polls, chat, and as of recently, actually call functionality. And it's a great tool for getting your friends together for a raid night or some League of Legends gaming night or something like that. As well as that, we are sponsored by Twitch, a platform you should be familiar with if you're watching us right now, as it's probably the one you're using to listen to me talk about it. And Asus, who are purveyors of everything esports. Monitors, laptops, routers, graphics cards, motherboards, anything you could possibly need, you can find from those fine folks. Now we're just going to hop to a quick musical and commercial break and be right back as we wait for the spectator delay to count down. Alrighty, everybody. I said it would be a quick musical break, and I did not lie to you. We are in and onto the rift for game number two here between George Mason University and Oklahoma State. Now, they're going to be swapping sides here, as is custom, going into game number two. So George Mason are going to be on blue side, and Oklahoma State will be wearing the red shirts, which hopefully none of them are Star Trek fans, because that does not bode well if they are. Now, perhaps a five-man stack here from Oklahoma as they are looking to aggressively head towards the enemy jungle, but they're going to get spotted out, and it looks like that's going to be enough to dissuade them.
And there we go. All right. For me, I always like seeing aggressive level ones just because it's kind of a throwback to the early, like, season one, season two, when you did see that every single time.
Oh, man.
Because early gold value is much more effective, but now, oh, can...
Can might be baited into going for this 1v1 with Firefly. He's gonna body slam over the wall. He's not looking for any trouble.
Yeah, Ione could have definitely either secured a flash away or just a kill if he had decided to go in there. But like you said, they were trying to go for the sneaky bait. Instead, Can is still forced to skill that body slam level one, which is definitely not what you want. You definitely want to go for the drunken rage because of the different the extra like damage reduction. Mm-hmm. But even still, hey, you know, it's kind of worth it. But at this point, we're going to be I at least expect this Gragas to be played a little bit more like a Maokai. You know, very high lane sustain, so you just need some mana. And you can afford to get away with the ability power early on. So that's why you see the Dorian's ring there. But oh man, Varus actually taking a ton of damage, trying to help out Guo just with the leash, and Guo as well, taken very low. So yikes, already a little bit of a rough start there for Oklahoma.
Yeah, Rout and Fear Shadow going at it as well, and we are putting the pedal to the metal right at the start of this game. No lane left dry of action, except maybe this top lane, I suppose. It's tank v tank, we might not see all that much in the level one. But I am going to be keeping an eye towards the bottom lane this game, because last time around we saw Varus and Avocado shoved back for the majority of the lane by this very same duo. Kondo and Alex were on Karma Varus, they had control of the lane, and it looks like it's shaping up to be exactly the same situation. They've got the early level lead now after that clever early invade to get a health advantage, and things are just not looking great for Varus and Avocado.
Well, yeah, especially as aggressively as Alex is playing. Knowing that you're going to have your jungler on the bottom half of the map, also knowing that you damaged the enemy jungler very heavily, it means that you can just play as aggressively as you want. If you do get ganked, chances are you can actually turn that around as a 2v3. Alex also super, super sick at landing almost every single one of her inner flames. So just, I mean, not a whole lot of bad things you can say about things at this point in time. Still looking forward to seeing what Cannon can do on this Gragas. He's choosing to fight in a Cannon minion wave, which is always a little bit questionable. So he is taking quite a few heavily bad trades, but he does have the sustain advantage. If you just talk about health and healing, doesn't have a shield, but we'll see how well that works out as this lane progresses, because this is definitely not a not a matchup I've seen for a while.
Yeah, and I think in the long form of that lane, Gragas does come out slightly on top because of that sustain advantage, but in any given small engagement, I actually would throw it over to Ionian, or Ioan, whose name has too many vowels in quick succession. But not only because the shield, I think, is just going to be a little more powerful in terms of the instant 1v1, like that, all that health that he can just get on command, but also he's gone with the Corrupting Potion start, so he's got just a little bit more damage to have access to for short periods of time and is better equipped for trades.
All right, so we did see a little bit of a deep trip into the enemy jungle here for Firefly. He was trying to check things out, and he did get in and out, both without being detected. However, he didn't really detect a whole lot himself either, so nothing ventured, nothing gained, I suppose. First gank of the game in the mid lane.
Yeah, he's going to get off the gravity well just in time for the stun not to land. End of the line comes down. It's a flash forward to secure the first blood going over to Firefly, and that is a darn good target for them to have it on. Not only is he on the carry jungle, but he was also just carrying out of the jungle last game.
Yeah, very true. Good coordination on the flash. Lesser players would have flashed in the mid lane as well, but Rout just let him have it, decided, hey, you know, he deserves it, giving it over, and that is going to be, like you said, a very good place to put a top lane, though. Both tanks get pretty low.
can hurt and
here comes Graves.
So no mana left in that Gragas. There's an Aqua Prism followed up by the Deadly Flourish. However, the Exhausted Abaris means that he's having a rough time in this duel. But the flash forward, no, the fourth auto crit is not nearly enough. Kondo still had the heal available, as well as a shield from Alex. And GMU, not only do they turn that around in the bottom lane, but they also claim a kill top lane, as you were mentioning before that fight broke out.
Yeah, and that fight top lane really well orchestrated, kind of the same situation as the first blood was in the first game. Even though this wasn't the first blood this time around, it's the same exact setup. Ion just fighting Can, knowing that he was going to stay just barely alive and win, not because he had the damage, but because his jungler was on the way. And yeah, backup was there. The cavalry arrived just in time. And Firefly now off to a 2-0 start, choosing to combine his jungle item instead of just going for raw damage. A little bit strange because he could just go for the serrated dirk, which would be kind of a more snowbally approach. Instead, he's just going for the safe, kind of the safe route, which will get him that warrior's enchant. And he's going to come back top lane looking for more. And this might be a buy and die from Can, who did choose to run his way all the way up to the top lane and might just be going down again.
Yeah, oh man, that was a fight that maybe you didn't want to pick. Body slamming fours means he doesn't have it to escape from Firefly's gank. However, the anchor landing on the minion wave could be just enough. Yeah, Can makes it out alive.
Oh, Firefly could have suicided for that one, but better to stay alive and deny Can, keep him weak. This is sort of the Munchausen syndrome kicking in. You just want to keep Can as inhibited as possible. And so he's being zoned out. He can't recall. He can't get to his turret. He's not getting experience. He's not getting gold. He's just getting further and further behind. This is really setting up a very similar situation to our first game where, okay, nice shield. Oh, nice second shield. This is really setting up a very similar situation to our first game where you just saw the first, you saw the top lane get completely out of control. It's just absolutely bonkers, and there's nothing that Can is going to be able to do.
Yeah, and what's even worse about this is that the kills this time aren't going over to the tank. They aren't going over to the Maokai or the Nautilus. They're going over to the Graves, who's going to be able to carry even harder with those and all that gold in his pocket. Barriss and Gabe Avocado showing some signs of life down here, though, as they actually pick a fight themselves. That's a good thing for Oklahoma. They need to show some more signs of life, but it doesn't look like that's happening in the mid lane as Firefly claims his third kill.
Yikes. Okay, so here's this thing about this Firefly guy. You ever heard like the slow and steady wins the race? That's definitely not his fault. Okay, bottom lane.
Yeah, Alex flashing forward, the snare onto Barriss. There are no summoners available right now for the Djinn, and he is easy pickings for another kill. Teleport down from Can, but finds himself in a 4v1 as his support just perishes almost instantly. And there's nothing he can do to save the situation.
Okay, so sometimes that's the strategy you want to go for. Say, hey, let's just play it carefully. We think we're the better team. So over a longer game, we'll probably come out on top. But there's also like waiting for the opportune moment. And I think that that's the strat that Firefly is going. Saying, you know what? I'm not just going to play this passively because I know we'll win eventually. I'm the better player, so I should be able to notice better opportunities to find ways to win this game. So these aggressive ganks, knowing when to flash, when to blow summoners, where to be, just all completely 100% on top of things. Even sometimes where he doesn't pick up a kill, like when he ganked top lane and denied Can two waves. That's exactly the play you want to make. Yeah, essentially, he was actually worse than dead because it took him longer to get back to base and longer to get back from base. Just denying him even more resources up there. So I gotta say, also on the other side, Guo's Nocturne, even though he is now level 6, will have that paranoia pretty soon. That's gotta kick into high gear. That is actually one of the saving graces that could get Oklahoma back in here if Guo actually does manage to turn this around. Oh, bottom lane.
Can needs that saving grace, but Guo is not the one there to provide it as he comes in less than half health. And a little bit too late to the party. He has to flash out himself, takes a collateral damage on the way out, and nearly falls.
Wait,
Fear Shadow has roamed.
Ion did an ult. He's going to get snared up here just a little bit.
Fear Shadow is gone.
Wow. Firefly almost overextended. Okay, so Go's pretty dead here. Root just going to like come over around the side. Oh, actually does get the Dunkarino for the kill. So 9-0, an even more dominant start. If that was actually possible here for Robert Morris. Mm.
And, George Mason are just... looking untouchable, this game. This series, really, as a whole. They've put in quite the performance, and I can't really point to a single lane that's been their weak point, that's been the exploitable hole in their defenses, you know? Like, sometimes you'll have a team that's really, really good, but they don't know how to handle macro play, or they don't know how to play around their mid lane very well, or something like
right,
that. But
right.
I can't find that. I'm not seeing a weak point. If you just look across the KDAs right now, every lane has kills, has assists. Rout is looking to pick up another. However, he does get stunned up on that gravity well. Doesn't quite bring down Fear Shadow. And it isn't the case of a star player carrying them to victory. It's just a really solid team across the board.
That's a great way of putting Octavian. It's not always, oh my god, the flash in the outplay potential was there.
But Fear Shadow just doesn't have the damage.
Yeah, no. I mean, he has a great idea, and credit to him for like picking that opportunity to go in. That's the only really way that you do win this. Well, that's another way to do it.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
Fancy maneuvering there by Firefly. He interrupted the animation on his collateral damage with a quick draw.
But. Yeah, very well played there. Fear Shadow as well. You got to give some credit to this guy. He was by far last game. The guy really holding his own. Bottom lane, here comes Guo.
Flash away from Kondo, the exhaust onto Guo. This is the second Nocturne ulti of the game, and it looks like it's going to be another whiff, as Barris nearly goes down on the back end of that fight.
Alex actually could have killed him there if he hadn't been a little bit too scared of Guo. Guo at this point just does not pose a threat. He's got his warrior smite completed. But yeah, like I said, just not a threat, and here comes Ion.
Yep, point and click. That's strategy we were saying of see hero, kill hero might work out here pretty well for Ion. He just really has to get next to anybody, and there's nothing they can do at that point onwards to get away. Well, Barris and Avocado do have some reinforcements.
Ion actually could have killed them both there if Alex had followed up here. This is just a little bit of an illustration of just teams not willing to go hard together. To be fair, that was probably the better play not to just go crazy aggressive there, but it probably would have worked out if they had decided to go for it. Now, Root actually missing an uncharacteristic snare there, or uncharacteristically missing a snare. The snare itself is very characteristic because that's literally what the spells do. But a little bit off center there, and that will allow his lane opponent Fear Shadow to escape alive. However, at this point, it's kind of like we discussed top lane. It's like, well, staying alive at this point is sort of just like prolonging you coming back into a stronger position. And even off the back of all of this pressure and the individual lanes, Firefly and Alex found their way to the Mountain Drake and will be able to take that one down at 12 and a half minutes.
Yeah, and this time around, there is no game two to look forward to. There is no rest of the series. If Oklahoma want any chance, they've got to start turning this around. I feel like they had to start turning this around 5-6 minutes ago, but maybe they've still got a way to come back into this one. They have just now hit some item spikes as a Yumu's completed for... Oh, boy. Okay. Nami turned into fish food almost instantly.
Man, Octavian, see, there you go. Another missed play-by-play opportunity. God, you had one job.
I said, oh, boy. Does that not count? I think two words is about the most I could have gotten out in that case. But here's the hard engage. Rout tossed back under the turret. And this is exactly what Oklahoma might need to come back into this. But they're just made of tissue paper at this point. Barely got touched by anybody and he died.
Okay, here we go. Going back in again. Firefly is just going to kill Can here.
Yeah, Can has no way to sustain through these fights. Zion hasn't even been a part of this. He's going to teleport in now a little bit late, and they'll keep the show
like, hey,
going.
Hey, guys. Hey, I'm here, guys. Let's go. Oh, wait. We're already gone. That was actually the combo that I was talking about from Oklahoma, the Gragas cask into a curtain call.
Mm-hmm.
Barris actually played that one beautifully, however.
That was a max range hook. Nicely flung by Ion. Very nicely done.
Yeah, I gotta say, I mean, Ion has just been a monster this entire series. The duo of Ion and Firefly has just been, you know, this is one of those find a more iconic duo I'll wait memes just waiting to happen, because they have just been working so well together, and even separately. Firefly is, definitely putting up the MVP scoreline, but both just pretty invincible in their own rights.
Yeah, Rout going to be grabbing a blue buff, and this is George Morris just going through the textbook motions to finish out this game. I don't really think there's much that they can do to lose this one at this point. They're 15 minutes in, and I think they almost No, they don't quite have double. My math is not quite right, but they are pretty decidedly ahead. I don't think there's any argument about that. Route could be caught out here, actually. Guo gonna be turning it back around. There's the fear. Actually, doesn't even have time to resolve as Route goes down with another auto. That's two kills now. Over to Oklahoma. We have a long way to go before they come back into this game.
Yes, they certainly do. Great tale to tell there, Octavian, the very long distance they do have to go. We'll see what they can do here. Explosive cask used by Cannon, but like you were talking about earlier, the delay on its activation when you do ult as Gragas, just really too sluggish to find a real pick there. I mean, they find their second kill of the game on the mid lane, but now, looking
good
for some action
shield,
top.
But it's not going to be nearly enough. Actually, no, Guo does manage to flash away. Ion is not really the target they want to catch out here, though, so not going to be too much that they're able to punish from Oklahoma.
Firefly got greedy. He was trying to save his ultimate, and he wound up not getting anything for it. But either way, I mean, pushing the top layer, the jungler back, pretty much, like I said, even better because it takes him even longer to get back to lane. Now, he does, it does not have his ultimate.
Whoa!
Okay. All right, that's what your ult does.
Yep, Firefly is legendary, a moniker I think well earned this game. The guy is 8-0. And the shove on the top lane. This is going to be a really dangerous turret to defend, but it looks like Oklahoma want to try and defend it. One shot comes through, two shot. Ion is the one tanking the bullets, though, and he's barely even feeling them tickle. Hand going to get knocked up and tossed around so very easily by GMU as they claim a kill off the back of an attempted engage by the opposition.
Ooh, you were there being attempted. And now we're going to see another attempt. There's a long-range stun.
maybe an overextension from Route. He does manage to flash away from the deadly flourish, though.
Yeah, Route just kind of saw his light flash before his eyes there. He's like, good idea, good idea, good idea, bad idea. So that's where the flash came in there. So nice respect, but that was only because it was preceded immediately by disrespect going for the play underneath the enemy base. You're like, okay, man, that's why you have those two deaths.
Yeah, and the only two deaths for his team. Route, least valuable player, LVP for his team. He's 100% of his team's deaths, Rapid. Come on.
Hey, he's 30, almost 40 CS ahead of his lane opponent. So even though the scoreline doesn't look super great, he's still holding it down. And he has made his opponent go, lower into the score line than anybody else.
That's true.
Granted, that's with some help from Firefly, but still, you know, the stats still holds. Root has been playing pretty well, and he's a little bit off on his stuns this game, but it did force a flash, so yeah. You know, you can pretty much stay worth to that.
And Ion was tossing the anchor to the other side. Really, they just kind of covered that whole area with danger. Speaking of danger, Guo is in plenty himself. Good lord. That's rather disgusting.
All right, well, this game is certainly giving me a little bit of deja vu here, Octavian.
Yeah.
At least at this point, 18 minutes through, 2 minutes remain, and you gotta say, with the storylines you were talking about at the beginning of the game, it certainly does look like Robert Morris are gonna be punching their ticket through closer to advancing the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, in fact, GMU are going to be securing a playoff spot with this series, and it looks pretty much decided at this point. There's the stun onto Can to start the fight off. Alex is not exactly the target they want to be bringing down, and Can just, he's trying his darndest. Give him credit where credit is due, but he simply doesn't have the tools to make anything happen anymore. And Firefly hasn't even been a part of this fight up until now. Collateral damage claims the double kill and does quite a bit of damage to that Nami as well. Collaterally, you could say, as Route is searching for the final blow here, but still can't find it. Avocado actually makes it out of that. Surprisingly so, but the inhibitor does not. And the hopes and dreams do not for Oklahoma.
I mean, their hopes will stay alive for now, but Avocado actually really impressive. Didn't even use exhaust during all of that to make it out, but it doesn't really matter who's alive, who's dead, because the base is just going to die anyway, and like, you can win with zero kills just because you kill all the enemy stuff, and that's certainly what's going down right now. And with Mountain Drake in their sights, that will definitely help them on their way to closing out this game, taking two inhibitors down off of that fight, and looking for more off of their upcoming push.
Yeah. And I do have to give some credit to Can in that fight, and in pretty much every fight, we've seen him trying his hardest. And that, I think, is really good. It actually bodes quite well for the side of Oklahoma, because even if GMU is just out of their reach, if this is a matchup that is just too hard for them to finish, GMU being one of the teams at the top of our bracket, they still show signs of life. They still are trying. They're not FFing, actually. We're past the 20-minute mark. They could just give up on this match. But they're going to stick around. They're going to try and learn as much as they can. And they're going to try and execute as well as they can. And I feel like that's a really good mindset to have as a team on a competitive ladder like the CSL.
Yeah, definitely. And even maybe not for this season, but next season, all about learning experiences, growing as a person, as a team, and all those good things. However, you know, wins are still wins and losses are still losses.
Yeah.
See how this one does shape up. It certainly looks like Robert Morris, closing things out much the same way that they did in game number one, going for this Baron, either to force a fight or to give them the objective that will allow them an even better way to close this game out. Now, hunting through the jungle, what can they find?
They find Fear Shadow very, very easily, and it's a 12-0 Graves now. Firefly holding half of the kills for his team, has put on quite a performance this game. And there's a flash forward looking for another final act to this play, but it doesn't look like he'll find it quite yet. However, this final inhibitor turret is going to fall. The inhibitor, I'm assuming, will go down shortly thereafter. And these are the last few moments of the match.
Wow, that's lethality. Edge of the night. Two of them now purchased. And here we go, looking for more.
Yeah, Gabe Avocado going to have to flash away as the depth charge comes his way. However, the Nexus turrets are under fire, and it's really just a matter of minutes, moments even, before this game is over. Nocturne immediately deleted as soon as he leaps into the back lines. But none of that really matters in the end. The Nexus goes down, and it's a 2-0 sweep, 22-3 for George Mason University, who clinch their spot in the playoffs.
Wow. Wow, really, really well deserved. 22-3 is quite the scoreline, Octavian. And not only did they do it once, but twice. Very, very dominant victory. And you know, we said coming into this, it was going to be a slight favor for George Mason, but really, you can see the difference here and why they are the school that does deserve to advance, and lots to work on there for their opponents. And Oklahoma State, not really a great showing. Top lane specifically looked a little bit weak. So some things to shore up, but at least, you know, the first step to fixing your problems is acknowledging that you do have one. So coming out onto the Rift, battling it out, that's what collegiate esports is all about. And, you know, learning from that, definitely a learning experience here. So school, of course, always in session here at the CSL, but it's a little bit more fun here. So I gotta say I'm a little bit biased towards learning this way than maybe in a few other ways. But some fun games tonight, watching a very, very dominant performance from George Mason.
Yeah. With all of that said and done, though, I would just like to give our sponsors one last shout-out before we switch the stream off for now. We are sponsored by Band Gaming, a social app and the primary social app of the CSL. They've got features which allow you to create groups, boards, calendar functions, polls, chat, pretty much whatever you could possibly need out of a social app. And whatever you could possibly need out of a gaming app, all rolled together into one for your convenience. Go ahead and find out more at band.us. As well as that, we are sponsored by the very platform which we are streaming on right now. Twitch.tv have been exceedingly gracious in sponsoring us for quite a long while at this point, and we are exceedingly gracious to them for their sponsorship. From PAX East and West and many more events, the CSL wouldn't be what it is today without their support. As well as that, and finally, we are sponsored by ASUS. We want to welcome them to the family for the 2016-17 season. They are providers of everything you could possibly need for your monstrous esports computer, from wonderful products such as monitors and laptops to routers, graphics cards, motherboards, and pretty much anything else you could need. Be sure to pick up some ASUS gear before you enter that next critical battle. My name is Octavian. I am joined here by the ever-suffering Rapid Casting, who's been up at 5 in the morning to help us cast these wonderful matches, and I'm still exceedingly thankful to him as well. And we're going to be cutting to a quick little commercial break to finish out the stream, and then we'll be done for the day. Thank you all for joining us, and we hope you enjoyed.
Only $14.99. missed the call. Download Band. Communication made easy.